नमस्ते, वेलकम टू मनोरंजनी सीरीज इन कर्नाटिक क्लासिकल म्यूजिक. यू रिकलेक्ट द लास्ट एपिसोड वी हैड लॉन्च्ड अ न्यू थीम wherein we have decided to take up kritis by the Trinity on common deities on which all the three have composed. So with that, we started with the Kamakshi of Kanchi, and in the last episode we had taken up Namaste Paradevate in the ragam Devaranji by Sri Muthuswami Dikshita. A few points that I wish to put forth before we proceed to the topic of today's Kriti is that there have been some feedback saying on what basis did we ascribe the Devaranji Kriti to Kanchi Kamakshi. So there are some references. Of course, Dr. Raghavan's book does not mention this, whereas there are other references which attribute this Kriti to the Bangaru Kamakshi of Tanjavur. Another point that I wish to also explicitly state that in the last episode, I had shown some 15 kritis by Muthuswami Dikshitar, which are said to have been composed on Kamakshi and Kamakshi of Kanchi, in which actually there are few kritis where he explicitly mentions Kanchi Kamakshi. Namely, in the Ekam Reshwara Nayakim Ishwarim, which is in the Chamaram, there it is explicitly mentioned Kanchi. Whereas in few other kritis, Kamakoti Peetha, that has its explicit presence. Whereas in few of the kritis, Kamakshi is mentioned, but there is no reference to either Kanchi or Kamakoti Peetha. Nevertheless, the tradition ascribes these kritis to Kamakshi of Kanchi. So with that comment about the last episode, I would now like to go to the Kriti or the theme of today's episode, continuing the same theme of Kamakshi of Kanchi. And today we have taken up the Kriti by Sri Tyagaraja. But today I would like to focus a little bit about the historicity of Kanchipuram itself. The Brahmanda Purana, which is one of the oldest Purana and one of the 18 Puranas, there we find elaborate mention about Devi. The Lalita Sahasranama, for instance, is a part of Brahmanda Purana. And the last portion of the Brahmanda Purana has got Lalitopakhyana. And interestingly, in the beginning of the Lalitopakhyana, there is a reference to the Ikshvaku dynasty and particularly Dasharatha, where Vasishtha advises Dasharatha to go to all the way to Kanchipuram and have the darshan of Devi Kamakshi over there. So a sentence appears in the Brahmanda Puranam where it goes as Netra Dvayam Maheshasya Kashi Kanchi Puradvayam. So it's described as though the two eyes of Maheshwara are Kashi and Kanchi. And it is also mentioned the Putra Kameshthi Yaga that Dasharatha performs, in fact, is taking place in the city of Kanchipuram. And there are references to this in the Brahmanda Puranam itself, where there are few shlokas like Athalayam Samavishya Mahabhaktya Nripottamaha Pradakshinatrayam Kritva Vinayena Samanvitaha. Nripottamaha here is referring to Dasharatha. Similarly, in another shloka, Tataha Sannidhim Agatya Devya Kausalyayasaha Sri Kamakoshtha Nilayam Mahatripura Sundarim. So here it is explicitly mentioned how he was accompanied by Kausalya and how they had come and had darshana of Devi over here. Snatva kam Kampa Taranginyam Drishtva Devim Chapavanim Panchatirthe Tadasnatva Devya Kausalya Nripa. These are different shlokas that I have quoted from Brahmanda Purana, which adds credence to the episode where Dasharatha along with Kausalya is coming to Kanchipuram and having darshana of Kamakshi. Not just that, there is another work called Saubhagya Chintamani attributed to sage Maharishi Durvasa. And interestingly, this Saubhagya Chintamani is like an Agama text. And to this day, the Upasana Paddhati in the Kamakshi temple of Kanchipuram follows the Paddhati prescribed by Durvasa in this work called Saubhagya Chintamani. And in the Saubhagya Chintamani also, Durvasa talks about the connection of the Ikshvaku dynasty of Ayodhya with the Kanchipuram and particularly with Kamakshi. So much so that he calls Kamakshi as the Kuladevata of the Ikshvaku clan. And there is the beginning of the Saubhagya Chintamani begins with an elaborate description of Ayodhya, in fact, interestingly. And then it says how Manu, Vaivashvata Manu was advised to come to Kanchipuram, so on and so forth. So we see that Kanchipuram from yore has found its mention in many of our scriptures, and in this case particularly the Brahmanda Puranam that I have quoted. Coming to Tyagaraja, as I had also mentioned in my last episode, there is a deep connection between Upanishad Brahmendra and Sri Tyagaraja. Interestingly, Upanishad Brahmendra's meeting with Tyagaraja happens twice in Tyagaraja's life. Once when Tyagaraja was very young, that is when Tyagaraja's father was following ardently this Upanishad Brahmendra. And it is said that Tyagaraja in fact got initiated and inspired by this Upanishad Brahmendra. Later when Tyagaraja becomes slightly older, in his early 40s, that is when he again goes to pay his visit, obeisance to Upanishad Brahmendra at the behest of Upanishad Brahmendra himself. So it is said that he had invited, and so Tyagaraja had gone on a pilgrimage tour. That is where we get to hear that he had visited different places like Tiruvottiyur, where we also see the Tiruvottiyur Pancharatna. So in Kanchipuram when he had visited, and that is where he had composed this only one Kriti which he had composed on Devi Kamakshi. Normally when we talk of Tyagaraja, we associate Tyagaraja's Kritis only to his sister Devata, that is Sri Rama. But then there are other deities on which too Sri Tyagaraja has composed. So if we look at, there are around more than 780 Kritis that are extant today. Of course, there are a few people who say that he has even composed thousands of Kritis. But then what we have today in print is around 780 plus Kritis. And if we see them, majority of them are composed in Telugu, and a very small portion of them are composed in Sanskrit. And talking of the deities on which the compositions are composed, this is the distribution. And if you look at it, there are Kritis that he has composed on Devatas other than Sri Rama. Of course, the major chunk is dedicated to Sri Rama, around 698 or so. And the next number is number of Kritis is on Devi. Around 39 or so are composed on Devi, followed by Shiva, Krishna, and few other Kritis on Ganesha, Lord Muruga, on Kaveri, so on and so forth, which have clubbed it under the category of others. So this Kriti that we have taken up today is the Kriti, as I said, by Tyagaraja on Kamakshi of Kanchi. This is in the Ragam Madhyamavati, and the Pallavi of this Kriti goes as such. Vinayakuni Valenu Brovave Ninu Vina Velpulevaramma. So here he begins this Kriti by praying to Kamakshi to protect him, like in a similar way as she protects her son Ganesha. Vinayakuni Valenu Brovave Ninuvina, which other god is there to protect me other than you who protected Ganesha? So that is the Pallavi here. The Anupallavi is Anatha Rakshaki Sri Kamakshi Sujanagha Mochani Shankari Janani. Again, he is describing the attributes of Mother Kamakshi. She is the deity who is coming to the rescue of the destitutes. Sujana Agha Mochani, one who removes the sin or the papa of the Sujana, the noble people. Shankari, the one who causes auspiciousness, and the one who creates Janani. So this is the Anupallavi. There are three charanams to this Kriti, and what is in vogue of all the singers that at least I have heard, that's that the third charanam is what is normally sung by people. But let me briefly explain to you the meanings of the different charanam. The first charanam goes like this. Naradha mulakunu varalu osagana undramulai bhusuradi devatalu raidini jendaradu dayachudarada panchipuradi nayaki. Now you may see here that there are few words which I have highlighted in red. At this point, I would also like to add this comment that this Kriti has come down to us through various editions. In the sense, there are different paddhati which singers have followed, and even in the written manuscripts, there are different variations. For instance, the Undra Mulai here is in books given as Unda Ramulai. Some books it is given as Unda Ramulai. So that actually is not conveying any meaning. And similarly, Puradi Nayaki. So some books it is given it as Adhi Nayaki instead of Adi Nayaki. Let me go to the meaning very briefly. Naradha Mulakunu Varalu Osaga. The way you have bestowed blessings on even the lowest of the people, similarly, you please bless us who are suffering. So here, Undramulai is actually an imagery that Tyagaraja tries to use, because in Telugu, Undramu means the Modaka or the Kodakate, as we say in Tamil. So the way it is actually steam cooked. So he is referring to that imagery to convey how the people on the earth are having the pangs of suffering. So in order to alleviate those sufferings, Tyagaraja is praying to Kamakshi. Bhusuradi Devatalu Raidini Jendaradu. By he's praying to remove the obstacles or these pangs of suffering undergone by the people on the earth. Dayajuda Radha. Oh, won't you have mercy on people like us? Kanchipuradi Nayaki. As I said, it could be Kanchipura Adhinayaki, the one who is the supreme leader of Kanchipura, or Kanchipura Adi Nayaki, who is the leader of places like Kanchipura and others, or the one who is the primitive or the primordial supreme leader of Kanchipura. So it could mean any one of these from the for this word. So this is charanam one. Second charanam here is Pita Mahudu Janahitarthamai Ninnu Ta Teliyaveda Talimigala Avatara Mettikanu Tamasamusaya Talajalamu Natarthi Harini. So here it is again a very beautiful reference to the episode where Brahma performs penance to please the Devi and requests Devi as a boon. He requests, the Brahma requests Devi to come and install herself in Kanchipura. Again, this particular reference has got reference in Brahmanda Purana also, and this is very slightly, it is also coming in Lalita Sahasranama, where it says Brahmopendra Mahendra Adi Deva Samstuta Vaibhava, the one who has been praised by Brahma, Upendra, Mahendra, so on and so forth. So here the episode of Brahma performing penance is elaborately given in the Brahmanda Purana. I'll not get into the detail, but here Tyagaraja is referring to that. Pitamahudu, that is Lord Brahma, Janahitarthamai, for the welfare of the people, Ninnu ta teliya veda talimi gala avataramethi, the one who prayed to you in order to incarnate in this place of Kanchipura. So he can tamasamu seya, in order, without causing any delay, Tala Jalavu, I cannot bear any more delay. So please come Arti Harini, Nata Arti Harini. So here some books again have a variation in this word. So it is Natarti Harini. So please remove all my obstacles. I cannot wait for any longer. So please, without making any delay, please come and protect me, the very purpose for which Brahma had prayed to you and had requested you to make yourself present in this place. So this phrase here, Tamasamu Seya, Tala Jalamu, they are archaic Telugu, and you may also note that Shama Shastri makes regular usage of such phrases. Now coming to the third charanam, which is popularly sung by all the singers, and this is again rid with lot of variations, Pathabheda, and some of the Pathabheda are also having, they are not Saragarbha, they do not convey the meaning. So let me take them word by word. Purana Dayache Giralu Mukuniki Rajesi Brochu Rajadhari Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Melina Ramasodari Parashakti Nanu. Nanu is again, it goes back to Pallavi. So Nanu Vinayakuni Brovave. So that gets continued. But then in some book it is given as Purana, in some books it is given as Purana, and some books it is given as Purani. And singers have also sung it in a various manner. Purana, if it is Purana or Purana, it only means O the primordial one. Purani means O the primordial one, or the one who is the primitive one. If it is Purana, then it could also mean earlier. So Tyagaraja is again referring to another anecdote here. He's referring to the episode where Kamakshi had bestowed her blessings on Mukakavi. Mukakavi is in one of the Shankaracharya Mathadipatis of the Kamakoti Pitha, who did not have the faculty of speech in him. So it is tradition records that Kamakshi had blessed him, and the first thing that he started speaking was 500 verses, which today we have it as Muka Panchashati. So here Tyagaraja is referring to that episode where Kamakshi had blessed Muka. So Purana, earlier, how you had blessed Muka with the power of words, Giralu. Giralu here means the power of speech. Dayache Rajesi, the one who made the speech to come to Muka, Rajadhari. Now here, Muka Niki makes sense, but then the book, even the T.K. Govindrao book also writes it as Maka Niki. And here I would also like to add a comment that many singers who sing it, they sing it like Maku Ani Gira Jesi. So they do the sandhi splitting in a very meaningless way. It is actually Muka Niki Rajesi. Ra, it's like to make it come. Having made it come, Rajesi. Brochu, even you protect me in the same way as you had protected Muka earlier by bestowing the faculty of speech in him. Rajadhari, the one who holds the moon on her head. Raja is moon, and the one who is Dhari, one who is holding the crescent moon on her head. Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Melina. Some version has it as Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Vasini. So that variation is also there. It means please come and reside in the lotus heart of Tyagaraja. Rama Sodari, the Virabhadra Shastri writes that this whole Kriti, Tyagaraja has written it addressing the sister of his sister Devata, Sri Rama. So the charanam, that line comes, Rama Sodari, Parashakti Nanu. Para, again, it's a very, very Saragarbha word, and Kanchi Paramacharya has dealt a huge line of discourse on the very word para, because there are different stages of by which this para can be understood. One thing that I wish to make, this the difference that between the Maku and the Muku is appearing because in the Telugu script, ma is written in this way and mu is written in this way. So there is very high chances of some mistaking mu for ma or ma for mu, because there is only difference of one curl that is different. So with that, I now request my friend Satish to take over and explain the musicality of Madhyamavati and this kriti. Satish.
Thank you, Ram. Namaskarams to all our viewers. Wonderful explanation about the Sahityam portion by my friend about this composition and about the different Patha Pedas also. But I would also like to add something to this. It is that I've heard two versions of the last charanam that we usually sing along with this kriti. Usually what we hear is Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Melaina Rama Sodari. But I've also heard a version which says Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Vasini. Yes, my friend mentioned it. And also Murari Sodari, not just Rama Sodari. That is also a version that is quite popular in the concert field. But what I follow as a singer is Tyagarajuni Hridaya Saroja Melaina Rama Sodari. And also, we sing Makuniki and not Mukuniki, because that is how we were taught. Hence, it is also a revelation for me to know that Makuniki is not the correct word. This could have definitely happened because of some difficulties in probably reading the script or transcribing the script. I don't know how it crept into the Pathandram, because as he rightly said, Maku probably refers to a tree and Muku refers to a person who does not have the faculty of speech. So the second one seems to be more apt, because only to a dumb person the power of speech is bestowed, and that's how the legend of Kanchi Kshetra speaks. Now coming to the Raga Madhyamavati, we had already dealt about this raga in considerable detail in our bygone episode about bhakti through anecdotes. In fact, in that, the first episode was about Adigi Sukhamu, a kriti of Tyagaraja in Madhyamavati. We had dealt about the historicity of the raga. We had seen its association with the pan system of music, where it is called as Chandurthi Pan. Also, its derivation from the 22nd Melakarta, and also the scope of the raga with respect to Graha Bheda, as in, you know, if a tonic shift is made, what ragas result, and how Madhyamavati could be explored in that way. But for today's episode, we would like to share some more information about Madhyamavati, as in order to enrich ourselves as students of music and also to make this episode a little more interesting for our viewers. When we talk about Sangeeta Sampradaya Pradarshani with respect to any raga lakshana, and especially about Madhyamavati, Sangeeta Sampradaya Pradarshani says that all swaras of Madhyamavati are nyasa swaras. Now here, nyasa means staying in a particular note. Now that staying in a particular note could be, say, elongation of a note or building phrases around a note, using that note in many, many phrases, or using the note as the ending note of a particular phrase. Now, Madhyamavati is an audava raga, meaning that it has five swaras, sa, ri, ma, pa, and ni. And practically, all swaras are nyasa swaras. But when we talk about Madhyama, in many of the phrases, Madhyama cannot come as the ending note. If you sing a lot of phrases with Madhyama, you ultimately have to come back to Chatushruti Rishabha or Sajja in order to complete the phrase. When we especially talk about Madhyama, the note cannot be the ending note of a particular phrase. You can sing a lot of phrases with Madhyama, but you ultimately have to come back to Chatushruti Rishabham or Sajjam in order to complete the phraseology, in order to maintain the raga structure. Whereas other swaras could be ending notes of many, many phrases. Now, why this is important is because, say, for example, if you sing phrases with only sa, ri, ma, and pa in Madhyamavati, and you have the ending note as Madhyama, there is a risk of it sounding like Sudha Savitri. For example, sa, ri, ma, pa, pa, ma, re, sa, ri, ma, this can be arguably Madhyamavati or Sudasa. And also, let's say we take phrases with only Madhyama, Panchama, Nishadha, and Satya. And sing phrases with Madhyama as the ending. This can sound like Sudha Dhanyasi. Hence, one has to somewhat bring, I think, all the four or five notes in order to establish, to in order to maintain the raga swarup of that would do justice to it. However, in the last episode, we had mentioned that only with Gamaka and the Rishabha and with few phrases, Madhyamavati raga could be clearly established. That is true. But when we talk about Nyasa, one has to be very careful in this aspect of using Madhyama as a Nyasa. When we talk about Madhyamavati as a raga mudra, two compositions come to my mind which have used, in which Madhyamavati raga mudra has been used. One is a composition of Muthuswami Dikshita, Dharma Samvardhini, Danuja Samvardhini, Madhyamavati Kriti in Rupakatalam, addressed to Goddess of Tiruvayaru, in which he addresses Goddess as Madhyamavati Shankari in Charanam. The other composition is a composition of the Tanjavur Quartet, where the composer uses the word Madhyamavati as a Sambodhana or as an addressal to the Goddess in the Pallavi itself. He says, Mangala Pradambulichi Madhyamavati. Also, an interesting information about this is that in the translation of the Kriti, the meaning of the Kriti, which is given in the compositions book of the Tanjavur Quartet, in Tamil it says that Madhyamavati actually means Goddess who is in the middle of Lakshmi and Saraswati, probably because of the fact that the word Madhyamavati has the word Madhya in it, which means middle. Hence, she is referred to as Parvati, who is in the middle of Lakshmi and Saraswati on either side. Another interesting aspect is equating the scale Madhyamavati to certain Hindustani ragas that have the same scale. One is Raga Megh and the other one is Rag Madhvatsarak. All these ragas have the same scale, the same Aruvanam and Avaruvanam, or Aru and Avaru, as they call it in Hindustani music. But Madhyamavati certainly has a very, very distinctive color because of its beautiful Gamakas, because of its beautiful Swarupa, which obviously comes out of the Gamakas, and which also differentiates it from its allied ragas, Shri and Manirangu, which are hardcore Carnatic ragas. Let's listen to the Kriti Vinayakuni Valinu Bruva of Tyagaraja Swami, the only Kriti of Saint Tyagaraja on Goddess Kamakshi. Namaste.
Na 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 tarara na 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 Vinayakuni valenu brovave ninnu vinavel pulevaruma Vinayakuni valenu brovave ninnu vinavel pulevaruma Vinayakuni valenu brovave Vinayakuni valenu brovave puni valeu brova ve ninu vina mel pule varau ma vinaya puni valeu brova ve ninu vina mel pule varau ma vinaya puni valeu brova ve anatharakshaki shrei kamakshi 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 sujana gamochani shankari janani sujana gamochani shankari janani vinayakuni valenu brovave ninnu vina mel pule varau ma vinaya puni valenu brovave urana daya jagiralu ma kuni kera jaisi brochuraj dari puran daya jagiralu ma kuni kera jaisi brochuraj dari puran daya jagiralu ma kuni kera jaisi brochuraj dari puran daya jagiralu ma kuni kera jaisi brochuraj dari tyagarajuni hrudaya saroj melaina tyagarajuni hrudaya saroj melaina ram sodari parashaktinamo ram sodari parashaktinamo ram sodari parashaktinamo vinaya kuni valenu brova ve ninu vina mel pule varau ma vinaya kuni valenu brova ve ninu vina mel pule varau ma vinaya kuni valenu brova ve
Thank you, Satish, for the explanation of Nyasa and Nyasa in general, and particularly how Madhyamavati, the Nyasas, which swaras appear as Nyasa Swara in Madhyamavati, and also for the beautiful rendition. Now, I began this explanation by talking about how the Kritis are attributed to Kanchipuram. Now, even though there are specific and explicit references to by Tyagaraja in this Kriti, in the Anupallavi, as I had explained, which also has finds its place in Brahmanda Purana, which without any doubt attributes his Kriti to Kanchi Kamakshi. There is another popular anecdote that this Kriti was written by Tyagaraja, composed by Tyagaraja, while praying to Kamalamba of Tiruvarur. Story goes that once when the deity was coming in the procession on the street, somehow Tyagaraja did not have the darshan, and after which he had to suffer through a physical malady. And Tyagaraja thought for himself that this physical malady which has come upon him is because he had not had a darshan earlier when the deity was coming on the street. Hence, he went to Kamalamba to pray in order to get alleviate this physical malady from him. That is where this composition was composed. This is what one tradition is. Now, if you look at the Kamalamba Navavaranam by Muthuswami Dikshitar, the Shankarabharana Navavarana Kriti, there also, even though that Kriti without any doubt is attributed to Kamalamba of Tiruvarur, there it is, one line comes as Mooka Mukhya Vak Pradayaya. Mooka Mukhya Vak Pradaya. Where even though it is Tiruvarur, the anecdote of bestowing the faculty of speech on Mooka is again attributed to. So these are the common aspects. Nevertheless, this Kriti is the only Kriti by Tyagaraja on Kamakshi of Kanchipuram. There are many interesting niche details about the temple, the architecture of that temple, and many more details about the deity Kamakshi as well as Kanchipuram, which we would like to take up in our next episode, which will be the Kriti by Shama Shastri. Needless to say, the corpus of Kriti that Shama Shastri has dedicated to are on Kamakshi. We will be highlighting one of those compositions by Shama Shastri on Kanchi Kamakshi in our next episode. Continue giving us your feedback and subscribe to our channel. Namaste.